All right, good morning, everybody. We're about to get started. Thanks for coming in on this very rainy San Francisco morning. My name's Jill Anik. I'm actually one of the staff members at Penn Wharton Entrepreneurship based in Philadelphia, but coming out here about once a month to support some of the initiatives happening out here. So I'm really excited to be here for the Penn Wharton Entrepreneurs Breakfast Workshop. So a couple housekeeping things before we get started. We will have a legal office hours session with Herb Fockler after the workshop. If you are staying for that, that will happen in room 645. If you're not staying for the legal session, please just make sure to go to the front desk, drop your lanyard off, and then depart the campus, as it is a class day today. So we do have the students coming in for classes. So I'm going to turn it over to Herb to say a few words about his session before introducing our speaker.
Thanks a lot. And thank you very much. My name's Herb Fockler. I'm one of the partners in the business law department at Wilson Sonsini, Goodrich & Rosati. Wilson Sonsini, if you don't know us, is the leading firm in the country representing high technology and emerging growth startups. And that's what I specialize in. So we'll be talking for an hour afterwards about some of the things that I've seen recently in the startup market, some of the trends, especially among valuations. That's one of the things that I look at a lot. You know, what are the valuations that first equity rounds are seeing? But generally, we'll open it up to any other questions you guys have about how do you start a business, how do you grow a business, maybe even how do you do an IPO and things like that. So please come join us for the hour after the session. And thank you very much.
Okay, so we're really excited today to have Julie Price with us to talk about how to make sure your product is user-driven and why that matters. So Julie is a Wharton grad 2008 from the MBA program in Philadelphia. She's an expert in product design and will be drawing on psychology, behavioral economics, consumer behavior, things like that during the session. So we're really excited to have her. And Julie, you can take it away.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. So I want to talk to you today about how do you make sure you're designing the right product with the right features and the right user experience and design. And I don't know if you've seen this cartoon or this picture before. I love it. Not only is it funny and it demonstrates the difference between user experience and design, but also makes it really clear how a designer could come up with an idea that seems really logical and really rational about how they think people will navigate and how to design the sidewalk, and yet the user experience, it is what it is, and sometimes it's unpredictable, and this happens more often than we'd like as product people. Many of us have lived through this in very sad ways. So the questions that we seek to answer are typically, what is the right product? What are the right features? What is the first MVP? What should that feature set be like? What should the design be like? And then after that, what is the right product roadmap? So what should you build out in what order after you've designed the MVP? And although it would be wonderful if we could attack this in the most, in the simplest way, by just talking to people, and just find out, ask people what they want, ask them what they need, and then make sure that they like your ideas. The problem is if you go about it this way, you're gonna be asking people what they want and find out they have no idea what they want. They can't envision what they really want. And if you ask them what they need, they'll talk to you about faster horses, which isn't helpful. And then if you just show them your ideas, all of the psychological influences will kind of get in the way. People are notoriously bad at understanding and predicting their own behavior. So asking a person just directly if they like your ideas, it won't get you anywhere that you want to go. So these are a bunch of common tactics that people use to try to design for people, bearing in mind their complex situation and psychology. Has anybody in here ever used any of these tactics? Okay, so most of you have. And what I'm going to talk about and what I'll argue is that regardless of which of these tactics or others that you use, there's an underlying philosophy that you have to understand and utilize in order to have valid information. I've seen so many times where people run experiments or tests or interviews, and then they end up taking the information a certain way, and it leads their project in kind of the wrong direction. So I'm going to talk to you about underlying philosophy that you'll need to apply no matter what tactic you take. These philosophies, you can think of them in terms of three steps. So the first is make sure that you're always evaluating experiences in context. Make sure you're making careful use of comparisons, and that you're constantly wary of the complexity of psychological influences. So I'm going to spend a bunch of time talking about this. But rather than just talking about it and telling you, I thought it would be more interactive and interesting if we did a series of quizzes. And that way I can see where you're starting in your thinking, and we can talk around it. So to start out, the first one we'll do is around testing your concept. I'll give you a minute to read the cartoon. So all these cartoons are come from a book called Talking to Humans, which is a great book. But the thing that this cartoon highlights in kind of a very blatant way is that there's a lot of ways to do this very wrong. And so we're going to do a little quiz about this. To get us set up, we'll do live polling. And you can choose between using text message or a browser. It could be a web browser, mobile browser. If you'd like to do text message, what you would do is send a text to the recipient 22333. And in the body of that text, you would type Julie Price 194. Otherwise, just go to a browser and type in pollev.com/JuliePrice194. Just giving everybody a minute. So the first one, so just bear in mind, this is all considering qualitative testing, about 4 to 8 or 4 to 10 participants per test. And I can talk to you about why. You know, if you have questions about that, I can go into great length about why you would do that. But the first question is, the best way to test whether a person likes your concept? And the answers are A, B, C, or D. A, talk about your product and ask what they think. B, show a product and ask what they think. C, show three products, let them use as they like, ask questions at the end. And D, show a prototype and give specific tasks, asking questions along the way. Okay, we're gonna start improvising, and then we can go back to this if it starts working afterwards. Okay, so instead of getting to see the poll, you wanna just shout out, what was your answer here, A, B, C, or D? Okay, interesting. We have a pretty good sense of what that chart would look like now. So you guys have said that the answer is show a prototype and give specific tasks, asking questions along the way. So this is typically what how people structure it when they run usability tests. A person would give a prototype and ask people to do very specific things. So when you're testing a concept, in my opinion, this introduces way too much bias, and you're not going to get good answers. The best way to test your concept is to actually show three different prototypes and ask people to think as they go along and ask questions along the way. And the reason is, if you give one prototype and you give very specific tasks, you're making a lot of different assumptions. So first of all, you're assuming that you know the specific tasks that people want to do in the first place. Every word you use, every intonation, every element of your body language is influencing that person that you're talking to. So by you telling them what to do, they're thinking in their mind, this is a game. I can use this product to solve this question. They're no longer thinking of themselves as a real person using a real product. B, you get into the problem of the person lives in a vacuum where they think this is the only option that I have. In real life, people have many options of different things they can use. So by having them use three different things, you get a lot more of a sense of what they would actually do, whether they'd use any of these three products or none. And then the other reason that you want to have them use three is people want to be nice and they want to seem smart. So they may like you. They certainly know you want them to like your product. If you have three, you're kind of spreading out the possibility that they just tell you that they like it just to be nice. So my opinion, it's C is the best way to go, and you can rely much more heavily on what you're going to see. Okay, so the next question, how do you choose what are the other two prototypes to test with yours? Either A, you test the most popular products, B, you do two products that are different to yours. C, you take the features of your product and you divide them into three separate prototypes. Or four, these are all good options. So if you want to shout out A through D. I know there's a little bit more nervousness now from the last one. So I heard D.
C.
C. Okay. So it's actually D, but all of the other answers that you've said are right, therefore. So it just depends. You know, you want to go back to what are your goals? What is it you're trying to understand? And what is going to best get you that answer? So you may want to test the most popular products if one of your goals is to try to understand how people see yours in the realm of their real possibilities. You may want to test products that are very different because it opens up the mind of your participant a bit. And also, most likely at the end of one of these tests, what you end up doing is you steal from each of the three things that you've tested. There are elements of everything. Even things you think are terrible, often they have little gems in them. So by testing three very different ones, you can get a better sense of where you should go. One of my favorite things to do is to take the features that you're actually considering would be in your big blown-up product, divide that into three. That way you can see how much of this that you were building do people actually really want. And you can't, you know, it's really hard to get at a lot of this stuff because of people's inability to understand what they really want and need. But breaking something out into three gives you some really, really great insight. The best thing that could happen if you really do have all of your features spread out among three and you really think you want to build all of them, and if the person says, God, I wish this was all one product, then there you go. You know that it's all very useful. Okay. So how do you ask questions when your test participant interacts with your prototype? So A, you ask what they think when they first see the prototype, so you get valid first impressions. B, you ask them to think out loud and ask questions at the end so you don't interfere with their thoughts. And C, you ask questions along the way so you can get top of mind reactions. So A, B, or C?
B.
Okay, so this is actually the hardest thing in practice to do right. Because no matter what you think the answer is, when you're talking to someone or when your moderator is talking to someone, you want to say, wait, what do you mean by that? Or can you elaborate on that? Or tell me why you think that. But the answer really is B. You want them to think out loud throughout, and you really want to be careful how you're asking questions. Because everything that you say influences them. Every word you introduce is a new vocabulary for them. You're giving them a structure. So you want to have them just think out loud because it's the most reliable thing you can hear. Their stream of consciousness, it's not filtered. They're not trying to be nice. That's the best thing you can hope for. Okay, and then the next question. What questions might tell you if someone likes your product? So if you're interviewing somebody, and what would be the question you would ask them to find out if they like your product? A, do you have any questions for me? B, do you like this product? C, when would you use this product? D, how much would you pay for this product? Or E, who is this product for?
D.
Interesting. Okay, so you all agreed on that. So actually, my favorite question to ask is A. So if you've just run an experiment with someone who's using your product, and you say to them at the end of the session, you say, do you have any questions for me? And they say, yes, when can I use this? Can I be a tester? Where do I find this? That is the most reliable thing you can hear through an entire study to know that you're going down the right path for that particular user. It's even better if you don't ask the question, but earlier in the test, they stop and interrupt you and say, wait, stop, when can I use this? That is unfiltered, that is gold. My second favorite question to ask is, who is this product for? Not because this person is a subject matter expert or because this person is a psychic, but because this person, if they give an answer that includes themselves in that category, that's a good sign. If you say, would you use this, just the influences are so heavy. But if you say, who is this for, and they give you a category that they fall within, that means that at least they think they might use it. Okay, and then the last question for concept testing is, how do you instruct participants to interact with your prototype? So A, ask a person to use a prototype as if a friend just told them about it. B, ask a person to complete your most common and important tasks. And C, tell them to explore your prototypes and learn about all of the features. Okay, so A's and C's. So My favorite thing here is A, because most likely they have some vague sense of what your product is. And again, you're not influencing them if you just tell them to use it. The reason why I don't like C is because of the word explore and the word learn. When you're testing someone in any form, even if you say, this is not a test, you're helping me, they think they're being tested, and they want to look smart, and they want to be nice, and they want to be helpful. You're probably giving them something to talk to you in the first place. They like you, you know. So asking them to explore and learn is like, play this game and see how smart you are. That's not really helpful. People don't use your product to explore and learn it. They use it because they want to achieve something or they heard about it. So A is what will get you the least influence. So most importantly, you can see, you know, going over these three points in the philosophy, the key is to get the experience in the context, use comparisons, and then be wary of the many psychological influences. And there's psychological influences not just in how you structure your questions and how you structure your tests, but in also how you listen to people. Because when people tell you something, they may very well mean or think they mean what they're saying, but the reality is so much more complicated. So there's a way to actually listen. So here's another cartoon. I'll give you a minute. This is, again, another extreme example, but they make these cartoons because there's some truth in there. So we're going to do this again, but this time we're going to do what a person says and what you should be actually hearing. So if a person says to you, I would use this product, what did they really mean? Did they mean I would use this product, I would not use this product, but I'm trying to be nice, or I may or may not use this product? Yeah, okay. We're getting the hang of it. Okay, and it's because you just can't possibly know why they would say that. They're filtering, they're reflecting. Okay, so the next question is, I know the type of person who would use your product. Is A, I may or may not use your product, but I know who would. B, I wouldn't use your product, but I know who would. Or C, I would not use your product. Actually, C. Because even if they think they know who would use your product, they don't know who would use your product. So really the only thing you can hear from that is, okay, it's not them. What they say is just, sadly, it's mostly garbage. okay, and the next question is, you should make this brighter or bolder so I would have noticed it. And that's A, I didn't see this, so you should make it stand out more to fix it. B, I didn't see this, but ignore my advice about how to fix it. Or C, I saw this, but don't like the overall design. Okay, so it's actually B, I heard one B. So I learned this the hard way. I first worked in usability a million years ago, and there was this one part of the page where I ran this test, and there was this one most important part of the page, and every single person says, I didn't see this. Make it bigger, make it brighter, make it bolder. So we did. So the next week, we ran the same test again. And this time, we were using eye tracking at the time. This time, the eye went nowhere near the section. So what we got out of it the first time was that they didn't notice it, but we were very literal with their advice, which was our mistake. So the next week, what we did is we made this big, bright, bold section just very muted, and we made it look like content, and that was the answer. So the key here, takeaway, is that you got to reverse engineer the problem that they have, and then you find a way to fix it. So the problem was couldn't see it, ignore their advice. Okay, and then the next part would be you should add blank, I would love it. And this is A, I'm your user, so I'm in the right state of mind, and this is a good idea. Or B, I'm not a designer, so ignore me. Or C, I have an idea, so think about why I offered it. Right, exactly. So that's the same principle. So it applies to both usability and the concept. This was really great, I really liked this product, means A, I really like this product, B, I may or may not like this product, C, I like the experience of testing, or D, I'm telling you what you want to hear. So I hear a lot of answers, and it's true, it could be any one of these things, but really what you've got to walk away with is I may or may not like your product. Basically, this was really great. I really like this product. It kind of doesn't mean anything, sadly. It goes back to why this is so difficult. People are talking to you. You want to listen to them. You can't always listen to what they're saying. Okay. And this is the last one. When can I use this? When will it be ready? A, right now I think I'm interested in using your product. B, I'm your user. I'll use your product. Or C, I'm just being nice. I'm not really interested in your product. So it's A. And this is actually the most exciting thing during a test. When a person asks me this, especially, as I said before, if they interrupt me and ask this, that's the best thing you could hope for. But even the best thing that you could hope for is still not a promise. It's them saying that they think they would use your product. So basically, I know this is very daunting because I've just been talking about all of the things that can steer you in the wrong direction and how cautious you have to be and how many influences there are. But there really is, if you do this the right way and you combine the art with the science, you can use an iterative approach to try to take your product from a point of unknown to really understanding what are the features, what is the MVP, what is your full product. And so I'll talk about the process, but first, another cartoon. And so basically, the process is to make this not happen, of course. And this is a common process that I've been using for a few years with a few different teams. And it's an iterative process. So if you have, over the course of several weeks, several months, whatever you have the luxury of doing, if you start out at a point where first you're capturing all of your ideas among your product team or executive team, so you would come up with all of your ideas and then figure out what are the top concepts, what is it you want to understand first. So break that out into maybe three prototypes, and then you go through the formal recruiting process, you make sure that you're testing your test structure, whatever that may be, because no matter how well and carefully you design your test or your study, until you actually run it, you don't know if it's quite right. So you test your test, then you run your test. Maybe you would do something like you would run a test on a Tuesday, for example. And then you would take your learnings and then disseminate that throughout the team, maybe, for example, on a Thursday, and then come up with what is it you've learned, what is it you want to learn next. Maybe you'd merge these ideas, maybe you would take other ideas from other products, but you would go back to that original list you had of all their ideas, and try to figure out what you want to evaluate next. And you would just churn. And you would run tests either on a weekly basis or biweekly. The fastest cadence I've ever done is running tests multiple times in a week. It nearly killed us, but we learned a lot over the course of a few months. A much better cadence is to run a test every other week. Then what you do is you can use this process to define what your MVP is, and then you can do that even beyond that, where you figure out what is your roadmap, what should you be building after you build the MVP. And my preference is to start with a low fidelity and then to move into higher fidelity as you go, as you're working through what your product should look like, what should your design be like, what should it feel like. So there's a lot right here, and I'm trying to cover a lot in just one slide, so can I answer questions right now about the process?
Are you going to talk about synthesis at all, sort of how you get from that initial study with your concepts and how you look at all of the data and get to the next iteration?
Okay, so the question is about the synthesis and how you would take that and move to that next test. So that's really challenging because that's really where the art comes in. So what I found is over time, especially if you're doing testing on a recurring basis over time, a lot of it, there's a tendency for information to have gotten lost. So you really need one person to kind of own that, and that person should be in charge of gathering what other people think and then synthesizing it into one document and then sharing it. How you structure where you keep all of these documents of past tests and make sure none of it gets lost. I've had tactics that I've used where we use Google Drive and lots of documents and making sure that we always have something that says what's all of our thinking kind of in full. But I haven't seen one strategy that works for everybody. I worked for another company that that used Jira and Confluence and things like that to aggregate it, but it's really, that's the art part.
I have a really basic question. How do you identify your test subjects or people that come through and do your tests?
Right. So that's unfortunately the answer is it. How do you identify your test subjects is a question, and that's the big it depends. So do you want to give me a specific, and I can answer how you would do that?
Sure. So if I'm trying to get at what the true needs are for financial advisors, how would I, would I call a bunch of financial advisors and be like, hey, can I shadow you, or hey, can you come?
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Scrappy is good. It works great if you at some point, if you plan on recurring, talking to people, accumulating some list, whether it's you calling people and just saying, hey, do you know other people I can talk to? Or it's shocking how helpful Craigslist is. Yeah, shocking, like the different types of people you can find on Craigslist. You post under jobs, et cetera, and you do a little post, and then you have a survey to make sure you're finding the right people, and you make sure the survey is not so obvious who you're really looking for, so you don't get people lying. But yeah, you can find a ton of people. Just keep a list, keep being scrappy, use resources, online groups to try, subject matter experts, whatever, just to try to get at them. Yeah.
So I missed the payment part of the talk, so we may have covered this. But do you have any thoughts about how this process might change if we are moving more on the hardware product versus software? Maybe just out of context, but if you have any thoughts on that.
Could you have an example of a type of hardware? So hardware versus software?
Device. Yeah. So there are certain benefits that the device would provide, and also potential end users trying to figure out form factor. There's a whole bunch of things that we're trying to identify.
So I worked on a project with multiple pieces of hardware and software as well. And the same philosophy applies. You just have to, you can test early prototypes with hardware. I guess the biggest way that I think about it is, what are the biggest questions that you have, and what is that experience that end user would go through with all of these different, whether it's a device or an app, what is that experience, and how do you replicate it in a way that it feels like that experience, even though it's not truly that experience. You won't have fully developed hardware, it won't look the way you want it to, it won't work with the app, but how do you make it feel, there's a metaphor I really like, like the man behind the curtain from Wizard of Oz. So how do you kind of act as the man behind the curtain to replicate some of that experience and evaluate just the part of it that you want to know? You have to be really, really tight with your user goals to make sure you're designing a study to answer that.
And then do you recommend using the same subjects if you go through iterations or get a new batch?
It depends on your goals. I tend to like new people for most things. Sometimes it's interesting because you can test what they remember, because they'll remember very little, much less than you think. So you just have to be really clear. And the thing is, when you're doing this sort of thing, it's always a constant experiment, your own process. So you would just, what I would do is, if you're not sure, run a practice test, see if you like what you're hearing and learning.
Okay. Yes. Building off her question, if you're building a product for a specific small group of people, then what's the best way to, and you have to do the same test, what's the best way to work with this?
Is it B2B? Is that why it's the same people, or?
So just say it's for a small organization. One discrete product for a small organization.
Yeah. I'd just be really cautious with what you introduce them to at each phase in the test. And then also, sometimes you don't need those exact same people. You can think about what is it about those people and find someone who mirrors them. You just have to be really clear on what is it you want to learn and what is it about that user that that is important. I don't know if that, it sounds like you have a complicated thing that you're...
Okay. How would you deal with services offering where you can't actually, so say, for instance, you're launching a new services offering that helps your users adopt the product that you sell at your company. It's a service, so you want to see if they're interested in the service, but you can't actually test it because you're talking about like a human that might be on site or something
you just want to test if people are interested. Yeah, that's easy. It's shorter. You know, you just run more of those tests, and then you would have, what I would do is make sure, I do lots and lots of comparisons, so make sure if you're testing a service that you want to find out if people like, have lots of other options for them to choose between. And that way you can see how they feel about all of them. And only one of them is yours. Or maybe it's yours in three different versions. So does that? So really, just to kind of close up, the idea here is that really is art and science. And here's another cartoon. So the behavioral science, experimental psychology, matched with the art of how do you even come up with the ideas, what are the different creative ways that you can come up with to validate them, especially when you've got some of these complicated cases of like a small number of users or hardware, software, you have to get really creative. It could get really interesting and really fun to come up with those ideas. Yeah, so that's it, and I'm happy to answer any questions now, and then also I'm available by email if anyone wants to reach out afterwards. So what other questions can I answer for anybody?
So let's say you have one prototype, no A and B versions, you know, but there's not really a comparable product that's out there. How do you get the feedback
So sometimes that's actually more interesting. If there's no comparable product and you only have the one prototype, there's, I guess, two ways. The first way is there might not be a comparable product, but for the problem they're trying to solve, are there other solutions? So that works really great because then their feet are really on the ground when they answer your questions. Because there's this one completely different way to approach it from this other completely different way to approach it from another completely different way. Are you trying to mainly get at, are they interested, or are you trying to get at the nuance of what?
It's less about the model of the idea, but more about does this format work for the product that we're trying to release?
So, I know it might feel like a step back and you might not want to do this, but another way is you've got your one prototype, take like two wildly different approaches with the same concept and throw that in front of people. And a lot of times, like I said before, you have an idea that you think is terrible. You know, you think this doesn't make any sense. But there's something about it that reminds them of something or strikes some chord or triggers something in you and you end up learning so much. So, sure. Go ahead.
You mentioned the 4 to 10 magic number. Can you explain that?
Yeah, so actually I prefer 6 to 8 is usually what you get. There's a point of diminishing returns, so you don't want to spend too much time with that's why I limited it around 10. It's better to take what you've got, iterate it, and then do it again, which is why you want to stop at 10. It's qualitative. As long as these people are fairly similar and your goals are narrow enough. That's really all you'd need. Some people stop at testing 4 people. I think that's not quite enough. I like to get 6. You know, if you're testing, a lot of what you're testing is behavior and just kind of overall themes, you don't need 100. You'd die of boredom. And you'd lose the point, the diminishing returns happens around 8. In usability, they stop at 8, but because this is concept testing, you can go a little bit wider.
How would you recommend testing willingness to pay for a product?
Right. I mean, the best way to test willingness to pay is to sell them something, unfortunately. In this sort of qualitative testing, it's really tricky. Yeah, it's really tricky. You don't want to waste up too much time qualitatively talking about testing. It's really about money. It's much better to test that. Pricing, it's much better to test with quantitatively. The best thing I've ever seen to just predict is just the excitement and them stopping you and saying, when can I buy this? Where do I look it up? Where do I follow up? But on 6 to 8 people, it's really hard to get at, you know, for sure, would they buy this? Would they be willing to pay? Just really hard with qualitative.
Okay, so
I'm curious what you think about pairing qualitative data with quantitative data in a study like this. I'm just wrapping up a concept test and am using, and I did, in addition to the concept test, I did use the Kanto model. And I'm curious if you've ever tried to sort of combine the qualitative and quantitative, how you bring them together.
Yeah. So, a great way we use qualitative and quantitative fairly recently is we had the qualitative, you know, it gives you the why and it gets you in their mind, it makes you empathetic and it gives you new ideas. That's the wonderful part about qualitative. But what we did is we merged that with Facebook ad quantitative testing so we could see, like, based on what we were learning and why, we actually had different landing pages. And we looked at the which ads got the most attention, which got the most click-through, which got the most conversion. So that way, with these two things going on at the same time, we could see what people were attracted to, and then when we talked about them, we talked to these people. Actually, another great thing we did is we did Facebook testing, landing page testing, so that we could get emails. And then we did qualitative testing on those people. That was really powerful because we knew, we thought we knew why they were clicking on the ad and why they gave us the email. But then when we talk to them, we can go so much deeper. And if you could kind of do that in a circular.
That's good for industry validation as well. Like if you're not sure exactly who to target, you can use that to really try to hone in on your market.
Yeah. So having them kind of going either concurrently or taking a week between the two and doing the quant while you're doing the qual, it can be really amazing because each one will answer one set of questions but ask another set. So you can kind of go back and forth to just keep growing your learning.
A question about how you would sort of frame the user testing session with the tester. So specifically, I thought about saying to people, oh, we're doing market research, or it's just adding new opinions, or how do you set that up? And then related to it, what about compensation? How does that affect?
So there's the compensation, and then how do you frame it would be your two questions. So I'll do the compensation first because it's easier. It depends on, what's your budget and what are you willing to spend. And are you talking about in person or on the phone or online?
I guess in person, ideally. And I'm wondering, like, how does that affect it? Also, does it change their behavior if you offer them a lot if you have a big budget?
I find, actually, you don't want to offer too much. $50 is plenty, but people really, really love, one of my favorite tricks is people, you'd be shocked how much people are willing to do for movie tickets. If you give a person two movie tickets that you can buy at Costco, they don't picture it as the dollar value. They picture it as a night out or like a wonderful experience. I've had people wait online 2 hours to talk to me for two movie tickets. It was blew my mind. If you could do something experiential, that's a wonderful gift, compensation. Or Amazon gift cards is easy. I've done a lot of testing where I do it remotely using a few tools online. And for that, we give away like $50 Amazon card. And then your other question was, how do you frame it? You want to, as much as possible, I don't know that there's a right answer. I just know what I've done. As much as possible, you don't want to use the word test, because if you say to them, I'm not testing you, but you keep using the word test, they think you're lying. So calling it market research, I say, we're working on some ideas and I'd love to hear what you think, or I have like a number of emails I can send you. If you want to reach out, I'll just send you the language that I've used in the past. But you could do some trial and error too. Just see, hey, I used this language. How did people react when I talked to them? And then just keep tweaking it.
So we're working together. But we have a question that's more along, how do you tackle the problem when you have lots of different ideas from your initial user research to the top concept? So for example, like to use analogy, like what we're trying to solve is like, how do you get someone who's very serious about playing sports to find a good tennis coach, right? And when we started getting interviewed, people literally, it just gets into like, oh, how long do I have to travel? Like, I don't understand what grade level they're in, the intensity. It just becomes so broad in terms of feedback we're getting. We're really having a hard time to kind of box out the initial test concept to get to the prototype phase.
Okay, so just to make sure I understand, so when you've done your interviews or your tests, people are talking about so many different things that you're having a hard time.
Yeah, we almost feel like, through testing, I feel like we lost even more information or more direction because there were so many different variables that came in play from our interviews. And we're wondering if it's because we're testing to be different types of tennis players or it's because it's too broad. How do we find our top, our focus?
Right. So, I mean, you can never be everything to everyone. So you do have to just narrow in on who exactly am I trying to help and what exactly am I going to help them solve. And I feel like narrowing in on that answer, it is, a bit of trial and error. What is it that you're, who are the people you want to be building this for? You know, what are you excited about as a team is part of it. And then, yeah.
What happened is we have pretty clear hypothesis going in. So we ask these questions. And then usually when we finish, it's like what other questions do you have for us on this topic? And this becomes a Pandora box because literally they're like, oh yes, I'm so glad you're asking me about this question. Here are like 10 different other things I really hate about this problem. I don't have answer, blah, blah, blah. So hence, we feel like a little bit of, great, we've got some knowledge about our hypothesis, but all of a sudden it's like, there are all these other things that they brought into the table. So that's why we're having a little bit of hard time.
Sure, so there's two parts of that. The first part is if people are telling you things all across the board about things, it just widens up your idea of what the product could be. They're also reflecting, and that could be the whole faster horse thing. You gotta be careful when a person starts telling you, and you can solve this problem, and this problem, and this problem, because you don't have to solve all their problems. That's one thing. And then the other thing is, I've found it in the past really challenging to design for experts in something. And you're talking about athletes who are very serious. It's hard because their needs are really complicated and really deep. So it's just a question of, do you want to serve that audience who are that serious? And what does that need to be? Does it need to be this feature rich? Maybe it does. Or maybe there's a kind of a less intense audience that you can serve. Sadly, it's just not an easy answer, but good luck.
Question from the live stream. Does the process or philosophy change if you're testing a product with children? And if so?
It's fun to test kids, yeah. It does change. With kids of different, I've tested kids of different ages. I prefer, it's called collaborative discovery, so rather than testing one kid at a time, you test two kids at a time, and you can't say to a kid, hey, think out loud, because that doesn't make any sense. So what you say is, talk to your friend or tell your parent, and you would have the kid, you'd have them talk to each other about what they're doing, and you kind of make choices together. And then also with the kids, you want to make sure you've got the right context. And also you want to make sure it's a little bit different with getting parent consent. So I was testing older kids, but one thing that we did is we actually went to the mall and just tried to stop people who were eating in a food cart because they were there and we can talk to them. So you just have to be a little bit more creative and also how you find them because you can't just find kids on Craigslist. So...
Previous question, Julie, about you were getting all these other questions. It seems like some of that material could be used for release two or three or four down the road. Like you first get out your simple version of the product, but then the next iteration for more people to use it or to engage with it is to know maybe what's their level. Are you proficient? Are you an expert? Or tennis ratings would be 4.0. Right?
So
wouldn't that be how you handle that? For the most part is think, okay, if I'm getting enough people asking me about this, maybe that's something I put in.
Yeah, you could. I think, absolutely. I think you'd need to test it out for sure, but absolutely. You just figure out what is... I was working one time on a project for very serious runners, and I got into this problem as well. That's why I really understand it. Some people, they only want it if you can solve every single problem. So it's just a question of your audience. And if you can do it in a phased approach with the MVP and then building out later, absolutely. That's a great, yeah. So sometimes, if it's a known product and it's a simple known interaction, like you're selling them this coffee cup, right? But if it's a complex interaction that happens over time online, you can't really do that because you'd still get faster horses. And you know, take an experience like, think, is there a product that you love, like a I love Alexa, right? Amazon Alexa. And if you'd have told me why I would love Amazon Alexa, I'd have thought you were crazy. Like, why can't I just look at my watch and know what time it is? You know, something like that. Oh, okay, yeah. So, that's true for theirs because it depends. If it is something that people know how they're going to react, just going back to the Amazon Alexa, I didn't know how much I would love saying out loud, Alexa, what time is it? You know, because that seems idiotic when I can look at my watch. But the experience of actually going through it has made me love it. And I feel like if you can predict how you would love it, you could use a conjoint. But if you can't, then it's harder.
For A/B testing and other such things, there are so many tools. And do you recommend, like, from Monitate to usertesting.com to Netflix, and all these companies have their own open source tool available. So anything that you found good or not, or how to judge which one to use?
Well, some of those tools are really for quantitative analysis, right? Like typical A/B testing where you're looking at traffic. And some of it, like usertesting.com, is more for the qualitative. And I feel like they're very, very, very different. So if you use the right tool for the right job, absolutely. But usertesting.com is really very usability focused. I used it recently for something it wasn't necessarily intended to by just playing with it in a way that you're not supposed to. And it worked, but you really have to be very, very careful. Anything qualitative, I'm kind of a snob. but the quantitative tools to Unbounce or any of these other tools that help you test landing pages or Capriza or any of these tools, they're all, for their intended purposes, are great.
Do you view user interface and user experience to be tied together, or in some cases, for example, the Alexa, the interface dictates your experience.
Yes.
And some other products, the user experience may dictate how you redesign the user interface. In general, how do you wrestle with that kind of concept, or how are they related? And does it matter depending on what products you're designing? Is it something that's conceptually that's not available, or does one choice of one over the other depend on the physical product that currently exists in the market?
So when you say user interface, could you elaborate?
So when you said Alexa, that's a voice interface,
right?
If I type something, that's a textual, physical interface. How the results come up or how my experience for that product depends on which one I use and in what situation.
Yeah, it's a good question. It's a philosophical question, right? About the user interface versus the user experience and which one should lead the other. And I, oftentimes I'd like to say, oh, I know, I have a strong opinion and I believe that the user experience should dictate or the interface should dictate. But I often make mistakes in that decision. So I find that you really kind of have to consider both at the same time. There was one time I was testing this idea and I said, it doesn't matter what it looks like. I want to know what the experience feels like. And so we ran a test on wireframes and it went really badly. And then we did it again because the interface really mattered. It had to be beautiful because the experience had to feel a certain way that only the design could have afforded. So we did it again with the beautiful design and it just completely changed the whole experience. So they're so intricately tied. I don't know if that answers your question.
I mean, it's a tough question.
Yeah.
Because we, as a company, we have that same problem. We're building multimodal interfaces. We can use voice if it's a hands-free environment. or the application could go to a physical tap mode when you were in a noisy environment. You really have no way of testing.
Yeah, yeah. That's where you have to kind of, yeah. I mean, what I would do is just get super creative and just keep trying different ways to test it and see what, I don't know if you read the book Sprint or Design Sprint, I think it's called Sprint, from the Google Ventures team. And they've described what their process is for kind of validating ideas in this ridiculously fast 5-day, fast-paced concept development and testing cycle that they have. And they talk about how they tested a robot, which was really cool. I wish I had a good answer.
So how do you take a product from using to loving to can't live without it?
That's the magic question.
That is the magic question. How you take a product from using it to loving it to can't live without it? Yeah, I mean, this recent project that I worked on, actually worked on it for just over a year, when we started, the team had a very specific idea of something that they thought people would like to use. And a few of us had a sense that this just wasn't gonna be enough for people to can't live without it. Our goal was to build something that people can't live without. And so what we did is we came up with every idea you could possibly come up with that would make this product amazing and people would blow their minds. So, and we did this, we did multiple tests a week where we tested every idea against every idea against every idea. And eventually we did get to the point where people said, and we heard this more than once, I would lose my job because I would be staring at this product all day long. And that was amazing. People think they would get fired because they loved our product so much. It just took lots and lots of iterations and lots of creativity and to get there.
You mentioned Sprint or Design Sprint. Are there any other resources or references that are your go-tos or that you would recommend?
So I kind of like to go old school with the philosophy, like Donald Norman's books. You know, Don Norman's books, like Design of Everyday Things, and he's got a few books about cognitive psychology, how people think. There's a lot of newer books and resources, but I really like the old school Don Norman and the book Sprint. I like the book Talking to Humans was a good and very short. You could read that in an hour, even if you read the cartoons. Other than that, I wish I knew like a group of people that were readily, a meetup group or something where people just went and talked about these things. But I don't sadly know of any other resources.
Recently, I was talking to the CEO of a startup. This is such a startup company trying to raise seed money. And they came up with the idea, this is a B2C business. For example, they say we want to have an automatic reminder, smart reminder for professionals. And I kind of questioned him to say, hey, have you done this thing before writing a line of code? It's just very easy to burn money. So in your opinion, to this kind of B2C products, what are the best ways to test an idea from hypothesis and make sure it's a product market fit before writing a line of code in your experience?
So I could tell you how you would structure a test. I mean, obviously I think you should run testing. This sort of thing, the way to run that test is you give, I've tested kind of reminder systems before, and what you do is you give somebody a scenario that, okay, let me back up for a second. You think about what their day looks like, this fake person. Do they go to work? What does their routine look like? You'd craft a story for a target user. And then you would have the test participant kind of take on this persona and then say, it is now such and such time, and imagine this just happened. And then kind of make it feel like they're getting reminded. It's kind of against many of the things I've already talked about in terms of leading to giving them too much information, but with this sort of thing, you kind of have to. And it's shocking how when you give a person a persona like that, they can take on that role and they can imagine, oh wait, I know what this feels like to suddenly get this reminder and I'm really annoyed or I really like it. So you could try something like that. Yep. You get a wireframe. Paper would be fine. You know, you hand them a paper, I don't know if the reminder system is on their watch or on their phone, but yeah, you would have a picture of the phone with the reminder. But you have to make sure you give them the full context of their day. So, you know, it's this time of day, you're in this location, give them a real experience to feel. You could do that on paper, and then later, I would actually, you know, send people real texts, even if you're doing it by hand, you know, throughout their day, just to get a sense of, in real life, when they're going about their day, how did it feel to get a reminder, even though it's not from a system, it's just from you, you know, just so that they can live it, and then you can get a sense of how it went. Yeah. Anything that you can replicate.
Do you have any tricks for working with stakeholders for whom the nature of this process might be new in terms of setting expectations about the iterative nature of it, how many ideas need to be generated to get to something really innovative or desirable? Like, how have you done that?
Yeah, we start out usually with a kind of a kickoff where everybody idea generates together. And we actually, if check out the book Sprint, because they do have a process for like that first day brainstorming. You have to change it according to what makes sense for you. And then just what I would do is try to host that first test really publicly and as fast as possible. And the good thing about it being fast is they won't expect much because they know you did it in like 2 days, you know? So, and then from that first test, they'll be able to see it and get it so much more than you can ever explain it. If you try to explain to someone what the experience was like and the kinds of things they would get from it, it's hard to absorb in as much clarity as you could actually show them. So I would just do it quickly. We did this once where we did a company brainstorming on a Thursday, and we had our first test on the next Wednesday, something crazy. And they were just blown away we could do anything that fast. And then just really just observing and being part of the review goes a long way for the team. Okay. Okay, well, thank you, everybody.